On day 6, we will be leaving Tucson, Arizona, driving through Phoenix and Flagstaff on to the Grand Canyon. We'll leave in the sun and travel in the snow. Let's get started. The music background for today is the Grand Canyon Suite by Ferdy Grofe. Many of the bridges in Arizona are so beautifully painted and designed to be not only bridges but artwork. Soon we're passing through Phoenix, still heading northward. It's getting a little cloudy. Now it starts to rain on us a little bit. It'll eventually turn to snow. As you can see from the blowing, it's snow now. It'll get heavier and heavier.
Oh, wow.
as you have one hit, they all kind of piled into each other. It's now getting so heavy, it's kind of hard to see very far, and we've slowed down substantially. Next, we pass through Flagstaff. Heading out of Flagstaff, it's still accumulating a lot of snow. It now quits snowing, but it'll start again, and then it'll stop, and then it'll start for the rest of the day. Note in the lower elevations, there's no snow accumulation at all. This will be our last town before we head to Grand Canyon Village. As we get nearer to the entrance to the national park, it starts to snow fairly heavily again. And now we're ready to enter Grand Canyon National Park, the South Rim. The Colorado River flows 277 miles through the Grand Canyon, dropping 2,000 feet during that. And the Grand Canyon is split between the North and the South Rim. The whole National Park is over 1 million acres, and much of it inaccessible. This is a rather large park, split between the North Rim at 9,000 feet and the South Rim at 6,000 feet. The South Rim is always open. The Colorado River that forms this flows about 1,400 miles through 5 states to get to the Gulf of California. It flows through 6 national parks and we'll be in all of them. It starts in Rocky Mountain National Park, then flows by arches and through canyon lands to the Glen Canyon Recreation Area, Grand Canyon, and Lake Mead. It is 277 miles long and up to 18 miles wide and about a mile deep in places. Its rocks range from modern times to over 2 billion years old, about half the age of the entire Earth, and it was formed about 5 to 6 million years ago. It is not really the waters of the Colorado River that carved this, but all the silt that it carries acts like sandpaper, constantly rubbing and washing down the canyon. Until 1850, this was just a blank area on maps when John Wesley Powell decided to explore it. He started in Wyoming and in 1869 ran the entire river through the In the 1880s, the first tourists started showing up to see this canyon, and in 1999 it became a national park, with about 5 million tourists visiting the South Rim each year. In 1938, the first commercial rafting started, and now about 22,000 people a year go down it. As we head on into the park, the snow slows down a little bit, but it'll be back and forth and even sleet and pretty good wind the whole day. We will be exploring this part of the park, and actually today we'll only explore this part and we'll drive out tomorrow. As we drive in, we go to Grand Canyon Village, which is the area where people stay and live. We'll be staying in the El Tavor Hotel, as located here. It is located right on the edge of the Grand Canyon, and we're going to go look at the canyon before we go to the hotel, just in case it gets where we can't see anything. El Tavor Hotel was named after Pedro El Tavor, a Spanish explorer in the 16th century. It was built by the railroad in 1905 at a cost of $250,000, which was huge at that time, and it was used to house their guests who came on the railroad. The rooms have been modernized, but most of it still looks like it did when it was built. Inside the lobby, it has that log cabin look, and here's where the stores are and where people meet, and just a good place to sit and fellowship and talk. The upstairs mezzanine was once a place where only women were allowed to sit. And this is our room. Starts to rain some as we head out to explore. First, we'll look around Grand Canyon Village. We'll go to the Verkamps Visitor Center. This was home to the Verkamp family from 1906 till 2008, when it became part of the park itself. It is now a visitor center and displays about what you can see, and also a book and souvenir shop. Next up is Hopi House, which was designed to look like a Hopi Indian dwelling. It's Native American arts and crafts and Navajo rugs inside. We won't get inside because it's not open at this time. Next, we'll visit the Kolb Studio. The Kolb brothers were those who photographed this area for a long time, and it has a display of their photography inside. The last place we'll look is the Yavapai Geology Museum, specifically picked out in 1928 to be a place where people could look at the geology of the area. And inside they have many exhibits and displays so you can understand what you're looking at. Now we'll head down to the train depot, which was built here by the railroad in 1905 as a place where tourists could come and see the Grand Canyon. We're going to pick up a bus here. The trains come from Flagstaff each day and go back each day, so you could ride up, see parts of the Grand Canyon, and ride back without having to bring your car. We're going to be riding on buses now for the rest of the time because cars can't go where we're going today, and so we'll have to ride the buses. This keeps traffic down and also parking problems down. There are three bus routes in the park. The red route goes to Hermit's Rest. The blue route stays inside Grand Canyon Village. And the orange route goes to Yaki Point. We'll be taking all three today, but first we'll be on the red route heading towards Hermit's Rest, and we will get here to the transfer point for that. As we wait on the bus, we have a good look around in this area of the canyon. Hermit's Rest. We now get on the bus and ride to our first stop. You can see the open woods here as we drive along. First stop is Trailview Overlook. From here we can get a good look across at the Grand Canyon Village and its many buildings and houses. And there's our hotel, El Tavor, on the cliff looking across at us. And this is another view of the Cove Studio. This is called Trailview Overlook because it overlooks the Bright Angel Trail to the bottom. It follows the Bright Angel Fault in the land that cuts across the canyon and thus allows it to walk down into it. There are three ways to get to the bottom. You can walk 8 hours along the Bright Angel Trail, ride a mule for 4 hours, or fly in a helicopter. As you can see here from the low clouds, there's storms rolling in and out of the area all day, and we get caught in many of them. As you can see from these next few pictures, the canyon is constantly changing. Cloud cover and rainfall, and then out in the sunlight with shadows. It's a constantly changing environment, and so pictures made of the same place look different every time you take one. snow will be on the ground both days we're here at the Grand Canyon. Now we move to Maricopa Point and get a good view from that area. This is a good place to look at the pygmy forest around us, made up of pinyon pine and Utah juniper. They're very drought resistant and they don't grow very tall. I can imagine explorers coming through this dense forest and suddenly stepping out and seeing the canyon. Sometimes, as you can see, the canyon is in sunlight and then it starts to snow again. Our next stop is Powell Point. Here comes another storm at us. Here comes the sleet. The little pools on this rock actually contain microcosms of organisms living in them. We now have reached Hopi Point, one of the furthest ones out in the Grand Canyon. It has a beautiful, almost 300 degree radius view. Here also we'll get our first look at the Colorado River and be able to see it at the bottom of the canyon. Some people just don't obey the rules. And now we're at Mojave Point. This will be the furthest west we go. We now head back on the red route, go through the Blue Route and over to the Orange Route. As we go through Grand Canyon Village, we pass the mule barns, which were built in 2006. They hand make all their saddles. On the Orange Route, we come to Yaqui Point, which is the furthest east point in this area of the park. And when we get there, it's fairly sunny to begin with. Now we head to the South Kaibab Trailhead, and it'll be the last one on the Orange Route. We'll drive by the others tomorrow on the way out. Right, now we have a very cold and wind-blown Deborah the Explorer. There are over 600 side canyons, many of which have never been even explored. We now head back to the Blue Buses and the Grand Canyon Village. As we get back to Grand Canyon Village, it'll be time to go eat. We'll be going to the Thunderbird Lodge to eat at the Arizona Room. Now as we walk back along the cliff to El Tabor, the sun comes out as the sun sets. And that'll be the end of day